Ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you please silence all personal communication devices as a courtesy to our speakers. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome from Woodrow Wilson High School in Washington, D.C., the Wilson Singers.
Let this prayer be your guide. 6
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Learning Forward's 2015 annual conference. Please give a warm round of applause to Learning Forward Executive Director, Stephanie Hirsch.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I'm still kind of shaking from that amazing performance, and the students are just behind us. Could we give them one more round of applause? Wow, I just love starting our conference that way, and welcome to our annual conference. We're honored to have you with us this year. And we want to thank the DMV educators for hosting us for an unprecedented fourth time. How many of you are here for the first time? I want you to stand. Please stand. We welcome you into the Learning Forward family. And we also invite you to come by the Learning Forward exhibit sometime during the conference. We have a small gift for you. Our theme for this conference is Lead Change and Maximize Impact. And there are some real change leaders in this room. Some of you lead change at the federal level, some of you at the state or provincial level, and some of you right in your system and your schools. Last year, some of you may recall that during my remarks, I recognized some individual Learning Forward members who reflect the qualities of great leaders and learners. Some of those folks came up to me later and said that their success really belonged to their teams. So as I thought about what I wanted to focus on this year, I kept coming back to that idea of teams. Learning Forward believes that the best professional learning occurs in teams. And there are some learning teams with us here at the conference that share the same quality of other successful teams that you may recognize. The most successful teams hold high expectations for each team member, just like the best music writing team of all time, Paul McCartney and John Lennon. They wrote 180 songs together, and they were deliberate and thoughtful in the process. As Paul once stated to John, with John and me on a song, if I come up with some line which I know aren't really very good, and I'm just hoping to fool him, I know I won't. The expectations that Paul and John held for each other remind me of the special needs team at Franklin Elementary School in Newark, New Jersey. Nicole, Ruth, and Samantha Second, third, and fourth grade special needs teachers push each other every day to achieve better outcomes for all students. As recipients of the Learning Forward Foundation team grant, they are taking their work one step further by launching a school-wide peer observation coaching program to support success for all populations. They didn't know they were going to be recognized, but they are sitting up front. So let's give them a round of applause. Medical team saves lives, and for 15 seasons from 1994 to 2006, the ER team grappled with many current social problems and tragedies while also facing their own personal struggles. Before there was a Dr. McDreamy, there was a young George Clooney and my guilty pleasure on Thursday nights. Every week, the doctors performed under intense pressure because each week, countless lives were on the line. The commitment of this team to its patients reminds me of the deep commitment of the Fort Wayne Community School leadership team. Fort Wayne is home to over 30,000 students speaking 75 different languages, with 71% eligible for free and reduced lunch. Fort Wayne is the second largest system in Indiana, and it's the fastest improving in the state. The leadership team is well aware that if they fail, the opportunity for a life well lived is lost. And fortunately, their trajectory is in the other direction, and the team leader, Superintendent Wendy Robinson, will be the first to tell you that team learning is the foundation for their success. Some teams are made up of ordinary people who unite into a single unit of incredible strength to battle a common foe. No force could withstand the combined strength of the Avengers. And I would suggest the same is true of the professional learning proponents in the state of Washington. Armed with new knowledge and a bold vision, leaders from the State Department, the Washington Learning Forward affiliate, the ESDs, and more than 25 school systems are taking the lead in transforming professional learning. They have located resources, adopted Learning Forward professional learning standards, and supported the redesign of the school year and the school day for increased job-embedded learning. Like the Avengers, they have been able to accomplish more as a team than any of them could imagine to accomplishing as individuals. In 1980, no one believed that this team would accomplish the unimaginable. A team of amateurs and collegiate players would enter the Olympic competition against professional players who held the international title for 6 years. Ultimately, it was the coaching, the practice, the team building, and the compelling vision that led all of us to believe in miracles. And there are teams that come together for a single purpose, and miracles happen. This is how the coaches of our 2016 Academy described this learning team. This team, known as GPS, serves urban, rural, and suburban communities. And yet they are all working on the same problem, building sustainable learning communities that increase teacher effectiveness and student achievement. They are all making progress toward their goals, and they attribute their success to the shared accountability they hold to their academy executive sponsor, to their fellow team members, and to their colleagues. Collectively, this team makes daily miracles happen for hundreds of educators and thousands of students. From day one, Mark Zuckerberg and his leadership team at Facebook challenged the status quo. Zuckerberg once said, "The biggest risk is not taking any risk. In a world that's changing really quickly, the only strategy that is guaranteed to fail is not taking risks." And my choice for two learning teams that shared this philosophy are the New York City and Denver IPD teams. These teams recognize that time is short and that students have only one chance for a great education. These innovators are known for challenging the status quo and taking on hard problems. While they may at times face resistance, early indicators of success inspire them to carry on. The teams know in the long run, the results will far exceed the investment, and they will not waver until they give every teacher what he or she needs to help every student succeed. And last but not least, Walt Disney built one of the most successful entertainment companies of all time. But he would be the first to admit that its success depended on his partners, his support system, and his cast members. The company's core values of service, leadership, culture, creativity, and innovation differentiate it from its competition. And I'm sure that Walt Disney himself would be proud to associate his values with this team that lives very close to Disney World. The Braulio Alonso High School Instructional Leadership Team from Hillsborough County, Florida. This team is committed to continuous improvement and collaboration, which isn't easy in one of the state's largest schools. It's deliberate in its efforts to examine data, set learning priorities, and engage in purposeful learning. The team works to provide leadership, build a healthy culture, promote creativity and innovation, and celebrate results. These outcomes led to them being named the 2015 Shirley Horde Learning Team Award winners. And they are also here at the conference as the guest of Corwin Publishers, the award sponsor, and they're sitting up front. So let's take a moment to recognize them. One attribute that these teams all have in common is that they set lofty goals for themselves and those around them. Our goal at Learning Forward is a bold one, and it's reflected in our vision statement: excellent teaching and learning every day. That's what motivates us as an organization. But we know that everyone in this room has their own driving force behind their professional learning. So, we're launching a new campaign at the conference where we want you to share what it is that motivates you to learn. You'll notice on the tables, we've placed some cards with the hashtag #WhyWeLearn. If you haven't picked those up yet, they're in the middle of the table. We want you to share with us your inspiration for learning. Let us know why professional learning is the most important investment we can make for educators and students. And then post them on Twitter and Instagram with the #WhyWeLearn hashtag. And we'll show as many of them as we can throughout the conference. In this room constitutes the most powerful team I know, one of truly passionate, knowledgeable, and committed learners. Let's make a powerful statement and tell the world why professional learning is the engine that will drive the future for our educators and students. Thank you. And now I'm pleased to introduce two members of the Learning Forward team, our Deputy Executive Director, Frederick Brown, and our DC Conference Host Committee Chair, Judy Newhouse.
Judy, it's great to be back here in D.C., or as our friends from Prince George's County will remind us, Prince George's County is where we actually are. I think we hear from some of them. There they are. But it's been quite a journey getting ready for this conference, and I'm just thinking we're here, we're starting the work. I want to thank you for all the hard work that you've done and certainly the work of your host committee and hosting this great event.
Fred, I'm so glad this day is finally here, and I'm so delighted to be up here on stage with you to welcome everybody to the conference. So how many of you were able to join us last night at the kickoff party and concert?
All right. Judy, should we show them some of our moves from last night? Okay, so maybe later. So it was a great chance to meet all of you, or at least a subset of you, and certainly during that time, we wanted to make sure that we recognize our first-time attendees. Those of you who come to us first to our Learning Forward conference, we honor you and recognize your attendance. And Judy, everyone in this room, everyone here is experiencing what we know will be awesome professional learning over the next few days. So what are some of the events that we have scheduled over the next few days?
Well, we have field trips.
Ah, that's right, we'll be going off-site. We also have a walkathon that's being sponsored by the Learning Forward Foundation. And we have some of those folks here as well. As a matter of fact, as part of the walkathon, before we even move on, there's a special challenge to see
right.
if certain folks can walk more steps during the conference than others. I think Vicki Duff, if you're out there, we're challenging you first. Anyone who can walk more steps than Vicki. I think she's at about 10,000 steps so far.
Woo.
And then tomorrow they'll be challenging me, and I'll be participating in the walkathon.
Good. Excellent.
Yeah.
We also have networking meetups and affiliate meetings tonight, opportunities to network and meet new colleagues and renew some of our friendships with people that we meet at conferences every year.
So we want to bring the host committee out in a second because they've done so much work to help make this conference a reality. But before we do that, we want to recognize some of our conference sponsors. Our legacy sponsors include the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and the Wallace Foundation.
Our capital sponsors, My Learning Plan, the National Education Association, and School Improvement Network.
And our gold sponsors, the American Federation of Teachers, Corwin, and True North Logic.
And our silver sponsors, Amplify, Just Ask, Solution Tree, Teacher Match, and TeachScape.
And our bronze sponsor, Observer Tab. A round of applause, please, for all of our sponsors. So I think it's time. Shall we bring out the host committee?
Let's do. But there's one thing I want to say about our host committee. Each committee member really takes to heart the idea behind our conference theme. They are real change agents. So we wanted to do something fun for our introductions. So please welcome the agents of change from your 2015 host committee.
From Baltimore County Public Schools, Karen Barnes. From the University of Virginia, Denny Berry. From Harford County Public Schools, Peter Carpenter. From the American Institutes for Research, Marianne Corley. From the Buck Institute for Education, Ashley Ellis. From the Washington Teachers Union, Sarah Elwell. From Virginia Beach City Public Schools, Janine Gorm. From Towson University, Ted Haney. From the Maryland State Department of Education, Heather Loggeman. From Fairfax County Public Schools, Jamie Lurson. From Prince George's County Public Schools, Felicia Martin Latif. From Anne Arundel County Public Schools, Zipporah Miller. From Chesterfield County Public Schools, Autumn Neighbors. From Arlington Public Schools, Sue Sarber. From Anne Arundel County Public Schools, Andrea Zamora. And from Learning Forward Virginia, Committee Chair, Judy Newhouse.
Okay, Judy. This team has done so much wonderful work over the past 18 months. They are an incredible group of folks. We are so proud of you and so thankful for all that you have done. Oh my gosh, what an amazing group. So again, our host committee, if you've seen them and if you had a chance to witness the work that they've done, you would understand why we get so passionate about thanking them. So again, a round of applause, please, for our host committee. Okay. So at this point, we're going to ask our host committee, thank you so much for being with us. We'll ask you to exit this way. Thank you again for the passion that you bring to this work. I'm loving these glasses. So at this point, we're going to recognize our our
service charity.
Thank you. So we're looking here, and we know that Stand Up for Kids, as we heard earlier, works to end the cycle of homelessness. And that project is something that, if you've not gone already to the host committee table and put your change in that jar, please do so, because that is an organization that is doing some amazing work for our students.
Yes, thank you, Fred.
Absolutely.
We ask that you support Stand Up for Kids by donating your loose change, because we're all change agents, at the hospitality table in the registration area. There are containers there to collect your donations. Also at the hospitality table are ribbons that you can use to decorate your name badge. And we ask that if you do select some ribbons, that you consider making a donation that will also go to Stand Up for Kids. So thank you for caring, and thank you for your support. All
right. Thanks, Judy.
Thank you, Fred.
So before we begin with our first keynote speaker, Sean McComb, Sean is going to speak to you from the heart. Sean is a classroom teacher of English. He is from the Baltimore County Public Schools, but many of you may know him as the 2014 National Teacher of the Year. Sean's personal journey and his commitment to ensuring that all students have access to powerful learning is something that is a motivation to all of us. And so we're very pleased today to have Sean McComb be our first keynote speaker. Sean?
Well, good afternoon. As Fred mentioned, I teach students English, which my wife says makes me either a fool or a masochist. And I have to tell you, like last night when I'm looking at this pile of papers that need feedback, I think she's asking a pretty good question. But English was just something that I could not resist. Teaching students to think about the human condition and to explore the essential questions of life was something that's just such a meaningful way to spend my day and to spend time. Exploring English also means that I deal a lot in narrative. It means that we explore the narrative or the plot types that you're probably used to and familiar with, the rags to riches story, the overcoming the monster, the comedy, and the tragedy. And we think about how some of those might apply to our lives. When I think about my personal journey, the narrative of the rebirth, I think, applies most prominently, with school playing a central role. See, when I was in adolescent, I went through a period of time where I was very much not fully alive. In second grade, my parents got divorced, and then I started to live predominantly with my mother, who was an alcoholic. That meant that home life was chaotic. It meant that our relationship was corrosive, combative. It meant that I would lay awake at night doubting that I was destined to have a bright future, and sometimes darker thoughts than that. And it was into that doubt and darkness that came the light of hope with teachers. I met Mr. Reagan when I was a 10th grader, and his after-school program, the Viking Channel, was my safe haven after school. It meant that I could be with someone who valued me and believed in me, who was easy to laugh and made me feel loved. In 11th grade, I met Mr. Schertz, who saw intellectual ability and capacity in me that I would have never believed in for myself. These two men absolutely, unequivocally changed the direction of my life. And so when I went to college, I thought, what more important and useful way to spend my career than to pay that forward? To have my own classroom where I gave students the conditions to feel valued and capable, to feel that someone believed in them and held them to high expectations so that they could become their best selves. I've been fortunate to have that opportunity. I was also given the opportunity to lead students through a program that focused on helping to create a pathway from poverty to possibility. We build a site of the AVID program at my high school that has helped students from the academic middle with dreams to be the first in their family to get a college education to flourish. And in the last four graduating classes, 98% of students graduating from the program have earned a four-year college admission. Give it up for those kids. And that has been an incredible collaborative process with our administration, with a team of dedicated teachers, with families, and with community. And now my journey has taken me to a place where I try to not only apply that still in the classroom, but also scale it within a district that is focused on becoming a learning organization to meet the needs of all children. Now, I don't share my story with you because it is so special or so unique. I share with you that story precisely because it is so common. Because it is so common to have people, to any adult or a child right now, say that it was the investment of a teacher in mentoring and supporting and believing in them that changed the trajectory of their lives. It happens every single day across this country. I share it with you precisely because so many teachers get into this work because they believe that schools can be an institution that creates opportunity, because it can be a vehicle for social justice in this country, because teachers work 10-hour days, and then they do professional learning often on their own time so that they can get better for kids, because we engage in work that calls on us to be courageous and brave, to share our trials and our triumphs. Because in schools right now, today, millions of children are reading and writing and singing and dancing and coding and making and problem solving because they believe that we know how to give them the future that they deserve. And we have to rise to that occasion. And that's the narrative that doesn't get told enough in this country. But that's the narrative that we have to tell. Now, I'm not up here saying that it's all lollipops and rainbows in our nation's public schools. I know that if we look at the data, if you look at the data and you don't feel frustration and urgency, then I would say you don't understand the data. But if you meet the people who do this work with courage and compassion, and you don't feel a sense of hope, then I don't think you have a pulse. And it's on behalf of those children that we engage in this most difficult work, that we call upon ourselves to share our stories, our successes, and our failures with courage here so that we can engage in a new narrative, the quest. The quest that we need to collaborate and be on together so that we can have learning in this country that is so compelling that school doesn't even have to be compulsory, that school could be the best 7 hours of a kid's day. That's a narrative that I want to be a part of. That's a narrative I want to join you as a part of. And let's do that together. Thank you.
Sean, we're going to have Sean back out here in just a bit to extend that conversation. Our next keynote speaker is Rehema Ellis. So Rehema joined NBC News in 1994 as a general assignment correspondent, and in 2010 she was named the network chief education correspondent. She's been the lead correspondent for NBC News. Also, she's been the Education Nation Summit leader that focused on the strengths and weaknesses of America's education system. Her reports appear on NBC Nightly News, MSNBC, and The Today Show. And Ellis is also the digital journalist who blogs and writes for NBC Online, as well as does a lot of tweeting on behalf of the organization. Rehema has received numerous awards, including national and local Emmys, the Edward R. Murrow Awards, the Associated Press Awards, and awards from the National Association of Black Journalists. It is my absolute pleasure to join me on the stage. Please welcome Rehema Ellis.
Thank you.
Oh, you know it.
I like the music. I want to tell them, I've got 15 minutes, and I don't want my 15 minutes to start just yet. I brought my stuff with me, but I just got to say something here. Sean is amazing. He is amazing. I'm going to talk a little bit about narrative, which he did, but I got to tell you this. There's a saying in this country that those that can do, those that can't teach. That is the dumbest thing I have ever heard. I am a parent, as are many of you. Most of us cannot teach our own children, let alone 30 to 40 of someone else's kids, who come with a variety of different experiences from who knows how many different cultures. And we ask you in this room to teach them, to guide them, to give them the tools that they need to be successful, productive citizens and participants in our community. Your job is absolutely extraordinary, and I thank you for your service. They weren't listening. They started the clock. So, a guy walks into an office, and he has his wife's glasses on. His workers, co-workers say to him, "Bob, why do you have on your wife's glasses?" And he says, "She wants me to see things her way." I guess I'm here today because you want me to see things your way, but also I want you to see things through my lens as a journalist. I've noticed on your website that it says, "Learning Forward is committed to lead, change, and maximize impact." I interpret this to mean the impact you as trained professional educators have on students. So now here's the tough part. Let me tell you my impression of how well you're doing in spreading that message of impact on students. Not so good. And this is weird, because all of you have taught every single one of us who are in the job that I am in to do what we do. You've taught me to be a good communicator, and yet you're not doing it so well yourselves. I get a lot of emails every single day, as I suspect many of you do, and that's really good. I get a lot of emails from educators, from school districts, from superintendents, from people who are just interested in education, who want to share with me what's going on in their schools. And I have to tell you, most times I hit a little button on the keyboard that says, "Delete." And the reason I do that is not because I'm not interested in what they're doing, but because their method of communicating the message to me is not very good. And if Mike, if you can hear me, I want you to put something up on the screens. This is an example of something that I got just on November 30th. As I was thinking about, I was going to come and join you here. Now, there's a chance that someone in this room may have sent me this message, because there are a lot of you guys in here. But I have redacted the name of the agency where this came from, because I want you to feel now like you're students, and as you always say, that this is a learning opportunity. So I want you to see something here of what I got. This subject is about, you can't see the subject line, but before it says, "Hi, Rehema," the subject is teachers trained to create garden programs for their schools. Let me tell you something. You see the things in circle? 10 times we see the word teachers. Not one time in this email is the word student mentioned. Not once. And you are here to talk about maximizing the impact. It's not maximizing the impact on teachers. Your ultimate goal is to teach students. At least that's what I think. And so at the end of the day, when I get something like this, the first thing I do is say, how's this going to impact students? I don't see it. And I thought, well, this is a good example. It doesn't tell me how students might benefit or enhance their learning or sense of self or self-esteem or participate in community service by growing and then sharing and possibly selling their produce. What it tells me is that this is a program to teach teachers how to teach students how to grow a garden. I don't know anything about the ecosystem. I'm not getting any sense of that. But I'm getting a sense that teachers are going to learn how to teach something. What I do as a reporter is to tell stories about things that are unexpected. That's the absolute definition of news. I expect you to teach. And I expect you to engage in professional development and learn how to be better at what you're doing. I expect it. So I'm not going to come and cover a story that says, guess what? I'm learning how to do what I do. That's not a story for me. If you say, guess what? I want to show you my kids getting down on the ground, getting their hands dirty, the soil is in between their fingers, and they're learning something about the ecosystem and how this goes this way, that goes that way. They're counting and they're doing all kinds of things. Come and see what we're doing. I will convince my senior producers to let me go where you are to tell that story. I want to give you an example about how important it is to manage your message, and you can do it in emails, and talking about being better communicators. Here's something I want to show you. It runs only 60 seconds, and it is about a hospital message. Mike, can you play that one for us, if you can?
They just said, go to Philadelphia. Philadelphia didn't want to touch me. They said to go to Florida. Florida didn't want to touch me. And then we went to all these hospitals. They just told us to go to different places. Then we finally found the one place, New York Presbyterian. So we went to the doctor, and Dr. Cato said that he is going to try to do the surgery. He took all my organs out and put the ones that I needed back in. And I was better, and I was just so happy to be better and cancer-free. That's pretty much my story.
What a story! If you happen to be in New York City and you fall down and break your neck, the one thing you're going to remember is, take me to New York Presbyterian. This little girl did not have a script. She wasn't reading from a prompter. She wasn't being guided by you or me or anybody. Somebody sat her down in a chair with a screen that's blank in the background and said, honey, tell me what happened to you. And in the sweetest, most innocent, most honest, most compelling way, she told what had happened to her. And the only thing that I remember is that it's a great story, she is well, and they helped her at New York Presbyterian. That hospital has managed its message. You saw the name of a doctor, but you didn't see him. But you didn't have to, because the doctor is personified in the health of the child. So you might say, we're not Madison Avenue. Come on, Rehema. We don't have that kind of money. We don't have people who can come up with those ideas. I keep telling you, you're teachers. You've taught the people at Madison Avenue. You've given them the skills. Did you hear Sean? He is you. He talked about the narrative. That's what you do. And if you say, okay, not Madison Avenue, I got about 7 more minutes. This one's going to take a little longer. But I want you to pay attention to this, because this you can do. This is about a public school who's managed its message, and it started out, and they had no idea of the impact that they would ultimately have. Be patient with me. This takes about 3.5 minutes, but every single second is worth seeing. Mike, would you play this?
Everybody, give a big hand to Marquise on the drum.
PS22 is a regular public school. It's not a magnet school for the arts. It's just a regular public school with some extraordinary children.
Who started this course was Mr. Wheat.
I came in as a second grade teacher, and there was no music program at PS22.
I remember that year, Mr. Breinberg walking through the building with his second grade class with his guitar in his hands at all times.
He asked to have a music class, and the former principal said, sure, why not?
You were a child, crawling on your knees toward it.
And we just love music with Mr. B. He just rocks. To him and to us, the key to music is just being yourself, like show your feeling, showing your emotion.
As Mr. B says, this is the quote, don't fake it, you should feel it.
So important for these kids to have that outlet to express themselves and to do it now. Because if you close up when you're in fifth grade, you're gonna be closed up for the rest of your childhood.
When I came here, I felt more open to everyone and I felt like at home.
Really shy in the beginning of the year, so I wasn't really sure whether I should raise my hand if I knew the answer. But if I can get up and sing in front of the whole fifth grade or people who I don't even know, then I can get up and just write the answer on the board.
I mean, I've seen parents with tears in their eyes come to me and like, I can't believe that's my child. I can't believe that's my child.
And it's been interesting to track. Over the last several years, we haven't had a child in chorus that's attended summer school.
1, 2, 3.
Justice!
Gonna be okay. Da-da-doo-doo, justice.
We are very lucky because not many schools these days do understand what the arts can do for a child. And, you know, great things have happened, more than we could have ever expected.
We started posting some of their videos on the internet, and artists whose songs we've covered have caught wind of what we were doing, and from there, that's when things really started to go viral.
Fabulous, perfect, soulful, yeah, amazing. Baby. I've seen the video 100 million. All the hits were me.
Nice.
To meet stars like Kylie Minogue, Katie Tunstall, Matt Damon. We met so many stars that we forgot half of them.
We got 25 million views on YouTube.
More.
I am here to officially invite you guys to play.
It's not really all the celebrities and all the TV cameras. It's not all about that. It makes it special when we just sit around and start singing in the auditorium.
Who else has that kind of luck that they can go to work and be happier for going to work? Most people are looking for vacation time. I was looking forward to getting back to work yesterday. That's the thing about this job. I am the luckiest man ever. Okay, you're killing me now.
Wow, right? It's the 21st century. Do not engage in 20th century tools in order to tell a 21st century message. You got one right here. Every single one of you has this thing. It's called a smartphone. It ain't smart if you don't use it in a smart way. It's just a phone. But it also can take pictures. If you don't have the audio-visual equipment at your school, you can take it on your phone. And you can upload it onto your Facebook. You can send it over to YouTube. Those kids got a million posts and likes off of their first video when they did Firework by Katy Perry. People looked up and said, oh my God, somebody likes what these kids are doing. What are they doing? How do they manage this? Who is this great musical director that made this thing go on? A guy who had a passion and a school who said, let's do this. They go on now, they've gotten 27 million hits off of the videos that they do. People are now getting a different impression about you. Because those kids who were inspired about school, it didn't happen because they were sitting outside in the yard playing with the squirrels.
They were inside a school building, and they were there with their teachers, and they were inspired. Not just for music. Did you hear her say, we haven't had one kid in chorus who's been in summer school? Not one. I'm preaching to the choir. You already know this. What I'm saying is you got to let other people know what you know. Manage your message. Maximize your impact. Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. You tell me all the time. Me when I was a little girl in school. You told me all the time. Use your voice. Now that I'm not a little girl anymore, and I have a little boy of my own, and I say to him, use your voice. And I celebrate his teachers who are helping him to find his voice. And I celebrate you for having the commitment and the passion to do what you do. And I encourage you to manage your message, to maximize your impact, to let the whole world know how well you're doing it. Thank you very much.
Rehema's going to join me back out here in just a sec as well, and we're going to have another extension of that conversation. So our final keynote speaker this afternoon is Irvin Scott. He is our friend, and he is from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Irvin works with the College Ready team at the foundation, and he's working to create more effective feedback and support systems for teachers and to spread the high-quality implementation of the Common Core State Standards. Irvin's work builds on years of experience as well as the foundation's intensive partnership, accelerated partnerships, and the innovation professional development sites. Irvin is deeply engaged in scaling and elevating effective celebrations of effective practice through the foundation as well as beyond. Before joining the foundation, Irvin was actually the chief academic officer for the Boston Public Schools. Do we have any folks from Boston in the room? Three of you, really? That's it. So he was from the Boston Public Schools, and he was also the co-chair of the Harvard University Urban School Leaders Summer Institute. So please join me in welcoming Irvin Scott.
I'm just curious. Evening news has about 8 to 10 million viewers, so it might be a little slightly bigger rush.
But you don't see them in the same way, I'm thinking. You know what I mean?
It's true. So, and this room is curious, packed, which is a beautiful thing. Good afternoon. Out there and see all those folks. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
Can you hear me now? Good afternoon, everyone. Let's try that again. Good afternoon, everyone. Before I go any further, I taught for years. I want you to help me give a shout out real quick to our two speakers, Sean McComb and Rehema Ellis. But I want you to do it this way. I'm going to say a shout out, and you're going to repeat after me. Shout out with the same vitality that my students used to do it when I was in the classroom. Everyone, let's try it. Shout out.
Shout out.
Oh my goodness, that was phenomenal. Thank you so much. I am so excited to be here, and I'm excited about talking a little bit about what we're learning. When I was listening to both of them speak, particularly Sean talk about his teacher story, it actually reminded me of the fact that about 2 years ago, I had the pleasure of being on this Learning Forward stage in Boston, Massachusetts. And I think we've got three people here from Boston. And I was able, for the first time, to share my teacher story with a large audience. You see, I taught high school English, very similar to Sean, for 15 years at J.P. McCaskey High School in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Anybody in Pennsylvania? Oh my goodness, Pennsylvania representing. I loved it with a passion. If you were in Boston at the time when I was talking about this, my teacher story, you will remember that I started off by sharing a picture of myself during my first year of teaching. I'm not sure if it came up there on the slide, but if it's there, don't start laughing. Then I showed a picture of another teacher, Mr. Gray, who had an amazing impact on my practice. My whole point 2 years ago was to talk about the emerging opportunities there were for teachers to connect with one another and grow together. That connection was essential for me many years ago, and it's just as essential now. Perhaps even more essential now in light of the new college ready and career standards, as well as new teacher evaluation and feedback systems that are moving across the country in a rapid way. Well, 2 years ago that was then, and this is now. And I thought I would take a few minutes to tell you a brief story, to keep the story theme, of some of what we're learning about what it takes to ensure relevant and impactful professional learning. I might add that so much of what we're learning comes as a result of many of you in this room. And so we applaud you for your contributions. This list is not meant to be comprehensive, but rather to highlight some of the key elements of what's happening in the field of professional learning. So let's jump into it. 10 quick lessons. And if you're tweeting, feel free to tweet at iScottFord. Tweet the lessons. Let's start a conversation. Keep the conversation going on. Lesson number one. Teachers are not the same. Neither are school leaders. They're not all the same. I know that makes me sound like Captain Obvious, but it bears repeating until we get it right. Teachers have different students with different needs. They themselves have different strengths and different areas of growth. They know they're not the same, and they're not crazy about having one-size-fits-all professional learning. Because one size doesn't fit all. Yeah, I can get a shout out on that. It's all right to say amen. Lesson number two. While there are some teachers who are okay. Those of you who know me know it was so hard for me to stand there that entire time. Lesson number two. While there are some teachers who are hitting it out of the park when it comes to student learning, and a few that are struggling in significant ways, the vast majority of teachers are striving to be great somewhere in the middle of that performance distribution curve. Like I was, striving to be great on a day-to-day basis. And teachers are seeking learning experiences that will help them accomplish that goal of greatness. Lesson number three. Improving professional learning in significant ways is going to require deep ownership and engagement and leadership on the part of teachers. Leaders also, but particularly teachers. This will require that we collectively create environments of trust. Everyone say trust. Vulnerability. And safety. Trust, vulnerability, and safety. Which will enable teachers to meet the shifts in practice and school leaders to meet the shifts in practice called for by more rigorous standards. As a matter of fact, in the recent TNTP Mirage report, the one factor that consistently showed a relationship to teacher growth across measures and at both the individual teacher level and school level was alignment between teachers' perceptions of their instructional effectiveness and their formal evaluation ratings. For example, improvers are almost twice as likely to rate their own performance as the same as their formal evaluation, while non-improvers are almost twice as likely to self-assess their performance as stronger than their formal ratings. Trust, vulnerability, safety. Lesson number four, teachers are connecting in powerful ways. Whether it's face-to-face or virally through social media, they are making connections in order to improve their practice and the practice of their peers. One big question for schools and school district leaders, how can we bring those viral communities into the walls of the school building, into the walls of our school districts? Teachers should not struggle or succeed in isolation. Isolation is the enemy of improvement. Everybody say it after me. Say, isolation is the enemy of improvement. Powerful statement. Lesson number five. We need to do more work to ensure that our teacher effectiveness systems, observations, and rubrics in particular, do a better job of reflecting the instructional shifts called for by college and career-ready standards. Teachers often experience new educator effectiveness systems as separate from college-ready standards, leading to incoherence and inconsistency. We need to bring them together. Lesson number six, professional learning must be impactful. Everyone say impactful. Say it with a little more life than that. Say impactful. We've been spending billions of dollars annually on PD, we continue to do this, with little investments in testing the impact of that PD on things that we care about, like student learning and teacher practice. Here, I want to plug a name, Thomas Guskey. Guskey, building off the work done by James Kirkpatrick, put forth an idea that the best way to evaluate PD is on the following five levels. Write these levels down. If you've never heard of Thomas Guskey, please write his name down. As a matter of fact, if you're tweeting, you can tweet at T. Guskey. The first level, participants' reaction. Oftentimes the level that we stop at. The second level, participants' learning. Did they actually get something from it? The third level, organization support and change. Did the system do something in response to the learning that the teachers or leaders experienced? The fourth level, participants' use of the new knowledge and skills. They just had an experience where they were learning something different. Are they actually applying it in the classroom? Are they actually applying it in the school? And then the fifth level, the ultimate level, what Rehema referred to, student learning outcomes. Are students different as a result of that experience? Too often we stop at level one. We need to move through all five levels. As a matter of fact, I had the pleasure of speaking to Dr. Guskey last week, and he talked about the importance of starting with level five, going through all the levels, and ending with level five. What are we trying to actually accomplish through the professional learning that we have, that we're moving forward with respect to student learning, and did the students actually learn as a result of it? Lesson number seven, time. Time is of the essence. We continue to hear from teachers that they lack enough time to collaborate with their peers, practice new strategies, look at data, look at student work. As a matter of fact, there are several districts right here in this room, or they've been here throughout this weekend, in Fresno, California, Bridgeport, Connecticut, Lake County, Florida, that have been wrestling with this issue of time, finding enough time. But what we're learning also, along with finding time, is once you find the time must be used productively, geared towards learning needs of students. Lesson number eight. There are districts and CMOs, charter management organizations, working hard on getting professional learning right. As a matter of fact, I am excited to announce that we have 20 school systems and charter management organizations from across this country poised to take on the challenge of building coherence and measuring impact of professional development. They've been meeting all weekend, this past weekend. They've been meeting to plan to make this happen, and we are so proud to support Learning Forward as they convene and facilitate their learning, and we look forward to the learnings that come out of that community. We're also excited about the PD Redesign partnership between Learning Forward and 25 key stakeholders in the professional learning community. I am convinced that we're going to learn a lot from these two communities. Lesson number nine. One of our best bets in improving teaching for all children in the U.S. is getting PD right, professional learning right for all educators. This is something that we at the Foundation are committed to in a deep way. And we at the Gates Foundation are excited and humbled to be a part of this effort. And we're sure we're going to learn a lot as a result of it. Lesson number 10 and my final lesson. We're at an amazing time with an amazing opportunity. We have access to more information than we've ever had about teachers, about school leaders, about student performance, about schools. We have robust, viral, and organic ways for teachers to connect with one another from school to school, from district to district, from state to state. We have emerging tools that are powerful that teachers can pick up and share with one another across the country. We have districts that are poised to take on the challenges in deep ways. This is our opportunity to make professional learning impactful. As a matter of fact, one of my favorite poems is entitled Opportunity, and it was penned by James Ingalls. And in the poem, the word opportunity is speaking, it's personified. Listen to what opportunity is saying to us now. Master of human destinies am I. Fame, love, and fortune on my footsteps wait. Cities and fields I walk, I penetrate deserts and seas remote. And passing by hovel in mart and palace soon or late, I knock unbidden once at every gate. If sleeping, wake, if feasting, rise before I turn away. It is the hour of fate, and they who follow me reach every state mortals desire and conquer every foe save death. But those who hesitate, condemned to failure, penury, and woe, seek me in vain and uselessly implore. I answer not. I return no more. We have the opportunity to write a new story about professional learning in this country. I don't know about you, but that's a story I want to be a part of. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Irvin. Well done. I love the fact that you have this passion around professional learning. Has the foundation, has this been a focus, has professional learning focused for long? Can you say more about that?
Sure. So the foundation's always been focused on how we can support and connect teachers with one another. We've been deeply involved, of course, in educator effectiveness systems, and a key part of the educator effectiveness systems has always been the development and support of teachers. So yes, it's been a major focus. And we're super excited to be connected with a lot of these communities. But it's not just Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. There are many other foundations that are trying to do this work in a deep way.
Wonderful. Well, I love the fact that you talked again about telling your story. So I want to invite Rehema and Sean McComb back out on the stage so that we can extend this conversation. So Rehema and Sean, come join us. So powerful conversation so far, and I really appreciate the fact that you are all telling your story and speaking and managing your own voice. Sean, I want to go back to you first, because one of the things that Rehema reminded us of was the importance of managing your message, using your own voice. And as National Teacher of the Year, and now as a teacher who's engaging in that practice, what did you pick up from what you heard from Rehema, and what are you doing to manage your voice and tell your own story at this point?
Sure. So on the one hand, I think what I took away from both speakers, who were both phenomenal, is to remember there is a challenge of the culture and ethos of education in order to do this work. We are not one to stand up and say, ooh, look at me, look at my school, and look at what we're doing. But we owe it to one another to engage in that, to not say, look at us and how special we are, but to say, we've made some progress here, we have some lessons learned that we can share from others, and to do that work. And similarly, that connects to the idea of vulnerability and safety in order to share our work and what we're doing. So personally, this year, I'm back in the classroom, and I'm sharing my learning on Teaching Channel. So I'm blogging with them. They came and filmed my classroom a few weeks ago, and I am making my growth and my challenges as a teacher transparent. And I hope that more of us will engage in that process and make our learning transparent to one another, even though it might not be something that's easy to do, it's scary to do sometimes, but it's something we need to do so we can learn from one another.
So I like the fact that you're using 21st century tools to tell your story, is what I'm hearing.
Yes.
So Rehema, one of the things that I know as an educator, and I think back to my own days as a principal, you're so busy living your story that it's hard to find the time to just tell it. And there's so much, you know, we turn on the TV and the negativity that's out there that we are trying to counter as educators. Say more about how we prioritize this. You know, I'm thinking we have a lot of district leaders in the room. We have a lot of school principals and other leaders in the room. What advice would you give to them to prioritize this whole point? And it's an important one about managing your story and telling your own story.
Well, if you're in a middle to high school, I think it's super easy because you've got some, you've got free labor. They're called students. and they love this stuff. You could give them an idea and they could run with it. You could make it a project. They could post something. I mean, you can go online at any point and you can see something that kids are posting. They're posting a lot of stuff that they shouldn't be. But how about engaging them to post something that they should and that could further the message about the school that you're in? So yes, it's hard on all of us. Time is of the essence that there just isn't enough of it. But listen to this. You know what? All of us, each one of us only has 24 hours in the day. I don't have more than you, you don't have more than me, and you don't have less than me. And you have to think about, what am I doing with all of my 24 hours? We just have to get smarter about how we manage it, how we engage other people in assisting us to do it. And I think that if you look at it that way, maybe you'll find that you have a little more time in order to get that message out.
Nice, thank you. Irvin, I'm thinking about the point you made about impact and measure the impact of professional learning, and professional learning is such a key lever. That story is also very hard to tell. What advice would you have for us as not just a Learning Forward family, but those who are engaged in trying to advocate for effective professional learning in our systems? How do we tell that story better?
Yeah. So one of the things I think we have to do a better job of in K-12 education is just tracking the professional learning that's happening for teachers and educators. We don't always do a good job of just tracking it. And you can't measure it if you don't know what it is, what is actually happening. So I'm super excited about some of the tools that are emerging. They actually, several of them have been around for a while, so I'm gonna plug a couple of things. Things like Bloomboard, True North Logic, Edivate, technology systems that allow us to do a better job of providing professional learning opportunities to teachers as well as tracking those professional learning opportunities. And I just think doing that better will help us measure the impact better, which is not easy to do, but you've got to start with what are people actually doing and then beginning to measure it. And the other thing I'd say is I wasn't kidding around with Thomas Guskey's framework. I don't think we in K-12 education use it enough. And I would just encourage us to go back there. It's a framework that's been around for a while and allows us to get to those levels of impact that he talked about.
Nice. Sean, I want to go back to you because your story is such a powerful one. And as you think back to your time as National Teacher of the Year, can you share with us an example of when you been able to not only share your own story, but hear a powerful story that you would like to share perhaps with the folks in this room?
Absolutely. You know, one of the great gifts of being a state teacher of the year, even in Maryland, a district teacher of the year, is how many other phenomenal educators you get to meet. Mm-hmm. So I get to go to Kansas a few times last year, and at one event I was presenting along with a gentleman named Brad LeDuc, who was a Milken Award winner there. He's an art teacher at a high school in Kansas. And he was just presenting the work that some of his students did that was absolutely outstanding. It was the first time he had ever presented. But his students did work, did 9-foot-tall murals for unsung heroes in their schools, bus drivers, cafeteria workers, installation art pieces that they put in their school. They did pieces that were installations with social justice awareness. So kids were taking issues that were close to the vest for them and putting things into the school building that other students had to confront. They could not be ignored. This was Brad's first ever presentation.
Wow.
He had never shared that before, and we're in a room with 100, 150, mostly teachers-to-be, and I'm thinking to myself, this needs to be on the evening news. This needs to be loud and proud. We have to share this so that we can inspire one another to continue to push.
Wow, You know, I'm thinking, Rehema, I'm going to give you the last word in a second, but your definition of the news is, I tell stories of things that are unexpected. And I think that's a powerful statement for us all to think about as we manage our own message and share our own stories. What final piece of advice would you have for us to make sure that we can make good news, the kind of news that shares our really strong, powerful stories, but they are the things that are unexpected?
Think about it. You watch television. You read newspapers. There are three, four stories in the Washington Post today about education. Stories are out there. What I think I would say is I want people to realize that when you do something great at school, because we hear so many bad stories about what's happening, those bad stories become, in some way, they become the normal. We're talking about the new normal in our society right now, in our country, in terms of the fear factor that people have. It's sort of a normal thing. We feel anxious and a lot of anxiety. And there's a lot of anxiety in our schools even. So that's kind of a normal. When you get kids who will say to you, something happened tremendous to me today, that's a story that I want to hear about. I was telling folks at the table just a moment ago, let me share this with you real quick, because I know you got to go. I was telling you about how a boy, 13 years old, in a school in Brooklyn, okay? Brooklyn would be the fourth largest city in the country if it were not a borough of New York City. There are 4 million people in Brooklyn. This little boy is asked a question by a street journalist who said, tell me the person who has influenced you the most in your life. He said, my principal. You gotta be kidding me. Your principal. The guy couldn't believe it. He thought he was gonna say, you know, a basketball player, football player, Jay-Z or some other crazy person. he said, you. So this guy puts this on his Facebook page. And now the kid elaborates. How did your principal turn out to be the most influential person in your life? He said, well, when we get in trouble, the principal doesn't bring us into her office and suspend us. She brings us into her office and tells us, I'm not going to suspend you, because if I suspend you, they're going to build another jail for all the other guys like you. I'm not doing it. He said, our principal stood up in the auditorium and looked at each one of us, came down off the stage, and walked to each one of us in the auditorium and said, you matter. Who does that? You matter. This went up on Facebook. They got 1 million hits. How simple. I keep telling you, you don't have to be Madison Avenue. Simplicity is beautiful. It is absolutely powerful in its impact. Maximize your impact by just doing the thing that you think that nobody's going to expect. And nobody expected it. If you turn that camera around on your students, and you don't even have to look for me, you don't even have to send me a message. If the message gets out to everybody, if the word gets out that you've got 100,000, 10,000, if you get 500,000, 1 million hits, I'm going to look for you. Because now that's a story I want to tell. You start trending on something, and you don't have to do it and say, now what can we do that will go? No, 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 no. Do what's in your heart. Mm-hmm. Do what you are passionate about. Tell the stories of your kids, and those stories will resonate all across this country and all across this planet. You have got some wonderful kids in your classrooms. You are doing some beautiful things with those kids. Share it in the simplest possible way. Now, your local newspaper, your local television station, they are hungry for these stories. Because most of the time they do stories about school, and it's about how the school boards and parents are fighting each other like cats and dogs. I spent 8 years of my life in Boston telling that story. If I ever come back again as a reporter, I will not tell stories like that. That was a waste of my time and yours, because it doesn't get to the root of, why the hell are you fighting so much? Mm-hmm. I mean, really, you want to do well in school. You want your kids to do well, and that's all parents want. But we're fighting about what color the paint should be in the cafeteria. Are you kidding me? So, long story short, find something that is compelling. See what your kids are interested in. Take the project that they have been just jazzed about. Put it up. Show us. And this is a fabulous age that we're in. We don't have to wait for the one person to come by with a little pencil and a piece of paper and tell your story and put it, you know, block the letters out and you got a printing press. You can be your own printing press because you've got the internet. It's the World Wide Web. Use it.
Wow, thank you. So, Rehema, Sean, Irvin, thank you for helping us think of ways to tell our own stories and to make sure that we are managing our own voice. Really appreciate the three of you. One more round of applause for our panel. And I want you all have a great afternoon. There are a couple things to think about for tomorrow. We have our walkathon. Remember, that's tomorrow morning at 6:30. I'll be out there walking, so hopefully we'll see some of you. Remember, please download the conference app. Anything that's changing, you'll see it there first. Have a great afternoon of learning. All right.